found outside. So that is a bigger reason. Thank you. I think the session should be over by now. In many other countries, they call it coffee break. We call it tea break, because India, we are more obsessed with tea than coffee. I'm O.P. Mal. I'm honored to chair this session. And the person who has been a strong source and the man who probably one of the few people who brought this conference to this country, and Mr. Mukesh Srivastava, he's the co-chair of this session. I'm glad that he's, in addition to he has only one paper, and that is in my session. So thank you very much, Mukesh ji. The session is on credit and investment in agriculture. I'll keep on making this innocuous remarks till the hall is full, but that will be, I hope that that will not be more than 2 minutes from now. Basically, any development policy in agriculture, you need optimal utilization of resources. So it can be land, technology, human being, and then opportunities to all. And in this whole system, finance work as a lubricant. So the role of, you know, what are the success stories if you see in agriculture, there is a positive role of credit. And very important, there is, if a lack of finance is a bottleneck in growth. So the both the things, if you see, probably we need to look at that. How does one intervene in a manner that is more result oriented and timely? For that, we need good statistics. So if you see the global experience, look at the case of Bangladesh, where Grameen Bank and microfinance institutions came, and they had a big role, and they still have a very big role. In case of Brazil, there is less of rural network of bank branches. So there the VC model has worked very well. And if you go to other regions like South Africa or Latin America, the models are different. And agricultural finance is done in various ways. And so our focus has been mainly on, what are the driving forces. And if we look at our total, basically two things become very important in the context of sustainable development goal. One is penetration of credit, and the other is that in terms of banking penetration, and then you see, so how, where and all it reaches, and the second thing is that how much is the reach. So it is that you have a credit flow and presence of the financial institutions in the, so we are going to dedicate our session on this issue. I'm glad that the countries that I mentioned are not here, but we have three country experience and a global experience, and I'm really glad that all the four papers together present a beautiful combination. Each supplements the other. We have a paper on India and the case study of Iran. Then we have one from Nepal, and the global perspective will be presented by from the FAO side by Mr. Mukesh Srivastava. The Indian position is basically telling that in a continent like a size country, you have practically all the credit information available at very, you know, in a very timely manner, especially from the banking system. Now, the credit you can take from two sources, information can be taken from two sources. One is the people who lend, and the second is people who borrow. In case of borrower, you can't reach everybody. Probably the size is very large. For example, for commercial banks, you see 180 million loan accounts are there in India. In addition, you have the cooperative banks, you have other sources of finance. In case of, so you have to probably talk to the lenders who are more organized. They have systems, information systems in place. So how, in case of India, the way estimates are prepared at very granular level and in a very timely manner, that experience will be shared. Then we go to Iran, where the ranking of states as per the agri productivity and the scope for finance. So this is done for states of Iran, but probably the same thing can be extended if you have cluster of countries also. In case of Nepal, the paper is wonderful. It tells you the issue that I told earlier, lack of finance, and how does it work as a bottleneck in growth. So if you, or how to remove, so all the three papers are basically dedicated to statistics as well as its use for policy making. And then we have the overarching presentation by FAO. So I invite first Mr. Saket Kumar to make presentation on the data-driven policy for financing agriculture. Mr. Saket Kumar, please. He has central banking experience for 15 years, and he has worked in the area of housing finance. He has worked on volatility. He's a trained statistician, and he has been one of the persons who has actually worked for what is globally acclaimed database on Indian economy, hosted by the Reserve Bank of India. I think it is one of the very well rated the online databases. So Mr. Saket Kumar.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity to present this paper. India is a large country with large and diverse population. Providing sustainable finance has been an objective of public policy since independence in 1947. The statistical inputs are critical. A small samples do not capture diversity in the country adequately. High frequency aggregate level reporting on fortnightly basis are supplemented by more detailed reporting on quarterly basis and surveys data. The focus of the presentation is to share the evolution of a statistical system which has supported banking development, financial inclusion, and sustainable finance policies in India. In fact, the production of goods and services needs optimal utilization of resources, viz. Land, human, technology, labor, capital, access to opportunities, etc. As mentioned by the experts, that the finance provides lubricants in the whole system by management of money in the process of modulating investment, borrowing, lending, busting, saving activities, etc. Absence of reliable source of finance can become a bottleneck in enhancing or even maintaining productivity in the farm sector. Agriculture finance has become an important input due to advent of capital-intensive agriculture technologies. Farmers require capital in order to enhance productivities of various farm resources. Role of agriculture financing starts with the identification of deficient areas that required focused approach and subsequently movement to formal sources of financing from informal sources of funding. Deepening of financial penetration and monitoring the effectiveness of policy measures have also been envisaged by policy makers in India. It has been practiced to utilize multi-layered information access basis as a requirement for the policy formulation at the national as well as the regional level. We require regular information by banks and other financial intermediaries. These information comprises of aggregated level high frequency statistics supplemented by nationwide surveys with a static and a spatial position. In this way, we capture evolutionary as well as temporal information. The information is having several attributes in terms of the size of the holding, gender, weaker section, loan, etc. First exhaustive examination into debt in India was concurrently accompanied by various provincial banking inquiry committees in 1929-30. It was followed non-uniform method for investigating conditions relating to rural debt. Many following studies dedicated on regions erstwhile like Mysore, Madras, Hyderabad, Bengal, Bombay regions. These generally covered debt in general and borrowing for agriculture investment were not collected separately. Nevertheless, such surveys provided critical inputs for agricultural finance subcommittees, Chairman Professor D.R. Gadgil, 1944-45, which studied several estimates across regions of India with the objective to suggest means for reduction of debt of the agriculture producer and outlining the framework of an organization by which they might be properly financed in future. The first nationwide survey on rural credit was conducted in 1951-52. It covered families in 600 villages selected by 75 districts across the country. It provided foundation for several major policy measures relating to agricultural credit where institution setting, formal finance and ease of access were emphasized. In the next nationwide round in 1961-62, investment was also added in the survey. The last decennial round of All India Debt and Investment Survey conducted in 4,500 around villages and 3,500 urban blocks were covered in central sample alone. In addition, there were state samples. With more focus on financial inclusion, NABARD conducted first round All India Financial Inclusion Survey in 2015-16 and assessed income levels of rural households as well as mapped aspects like debt, saving, investment, insurance, pension and financial aptitude behavior of individuals. These surveys have provided immense support in policy formulation over the years. There is a drastic shift in the source of rural liability since 1952 to 2012 as depicted in All India Rural Credit Survey. Around 55% of total liability of rural India pertains to formal institution in 2012. The same was around 5% in 1952. The age-old problem of rural credit has been the excessive reliance on the borrowers on the money lenders and other informal sources that have entailed usurious interest rate and exploitation. It is quite remarkable how long it has taken to really substitute institutional credit for informal money lending channels and how torturous the process of change has been. Change of any significance took around 75 years from beginning of the serious attention in 1930s to recent period. It was nationalization of banks in 1969 and subsequent spread of rural bank branches that has really made a difference in reducing finally the shares of money lenders in the agriculture credit. Agriculture credit clearly started to grow after bank nationalization and it has been growing continuously since then. With all concern and skepticism expressed, the difficult and continuous change in institutional credit have indeed borne fruit. Over the years, there has been a significant increase in the access of rural cultivators to institutional credit and simultaneously the role of informal agency, including money lenders, as a source of credit has declined. Presently, more than 80% of institutional agricultural credit is being disbursed by serial commercial banks and regional rural banks in India. The rest proportion are disbursed by cooperative societies and microfinance institutions. Given the volume of the rural credit and banks' pan-India coverage, detailed monitoring of bank credit has been established by us for monitoring and reporting as per central bank's requirement. Two important changes, viz. Setting of National Credit Council and nationalization of banks, happened during 1960s. In 1967, social controls over banks were proposed with a view to securing a better alignment of banking system to the needs of economic policy, and National Credit Council set up to provide a forum to discuss and assess the credit priorities on all India basis. In 1969, major commercial banks were nationalized to serve better the need of the developments of the economy in conformity with the national policy objectives. Basic statistical return system was introduced in 1972 for getting a comprehensive and reliable statistics on a banking in view of fast-growing network of branches after the nationalization of larger banks. Distribution aspect of serial commercial banks, office network, credit deposits, geographical purposes, ownership and investment portfolio have been envisaged under the BSR system. The credit information have been refined in 2013 by modifying basic statistical return 1 system suitably by assuming unique number to all credit data on quarterly basis. It now collects loan account level information of characteristics such as occupation, activity, organizational sector, gender of borrower, type of account, interest rates, and even the asset quality. As per the January 2019 press release of RBI, there are around 200 million credit account and 2 billion deposit account reported in the BSR system. Sustainable development is often described as being built on three equally important foundations or pillars, viz. Social development, environmental protection, and economic development. Since no development is possible without a sound financial system supporting it, the spotlight has been on aligning the financial system with sustainable development. We in the RBI have been conscious of the role of banks in providing finance for sustainable development. India's focus on harnessing financial system to provide to socially important segments actually dates back to even pre-nationalization days and got great impetus after bank nationalization. A core of financial policy in India is the priority sector lending requirement for banks to allocate 40% of lending to key socially important sectors such as agriculture and small and medium-sized enterprises. For individual households, the loan limit has also been revised and raised over the period of time. Priority sector lending norms focus on increasing commercial finance to segments of the population activities that require more financial attention and inclusion. Without priority sector norms, there are sub-targets for agriculture, within priority sector norms, there are sub-targets for agriculture, micro-enterprise, and weaker sections, particularly poor class. Lending under priority sector by banks are monitored regularly by RBI. The regular reporting provides rich information base for focusing on deficit sectors, area, and subsequently fine-tuning of the norms for improvement in those areas. Direct lending implies to individual farmers, including self-help groups for dairies, piggeries, goatries, poultry, and beekeeping, among other activities. It includes crop loans, investment credit, post-harvest credit, etc. Indirect lending entails loans to agro and food processing units, finance for purchase of agri machinery, loan to NBFCs, non-banking financial companies, and for the construction of storage facilities, among other activities that require more capital than direct lending. We are monitoring all these parameters separately for our own policy purposes. After more than 70 years of constant efforts, institutional credit is indeed reaching a substantial proportion of farmers, with the share of agriculture falling to total GVA due to more contribution of services sector, but the ratio of agriculture credit to total bank credit remained above 10% during last 20 years. RBI captures bank branch statistics as a repository of information on commercial banks' branches, offices, and it is based on national population census. Branch offices are classified in the form of population groups like rural, semi-urban, urban, metropolitan, tier of region, etc. Under this setup, banks and branches are given BSR codes to uniquely identify them and their location, like a state, district, revenue centers, village, town, etc. A statistics is used in observing regulatory compliances and a status of financial inclusion, as it helps in knowing penetration of banking through brick-mortar structure, ATMs, presence of ATMs, fixed location, banking correspondence, etc. It also strengthens inclusion policies, as commercial banks have presence in nearly 49,000 centers across the countries in addition to cooperatives and banking correspondents. This is a visualization of a statewide direct agriculture credit data. The same information can be generated for the cities, districts, block, village levels with the help of master office file, that is a BSR, part of BSR data. MOF system becomes a basis for framing financial inclusion policies in India over the years, as it helps in monitoring progress on reach of bank branches and banking outlets and in identifying of potential area of increased financing. It also helps in assessing gender-wise details on account holders. Linking reporting of banking variables with BSR codes enables generation of statistics as per required classification disaggregation. Regular and comprehensive reviews on agriculture credit system financial inclusion position have relied on these data on bank centers, banking correspondents, etc. In fact, we have also been disseminating these information to public domain through our database on Indian Economy website. That is a huge information data set. Anybody can access it and use it. Even the MOF system becomes a basis for framing, In addition to the banking loans, another factor for financial comfort is insurance in agriculture sector. India witnessed many agriculture Bima Yojanas or insurance planning, like Comprehensive Crop Insurance Scheme 1985 to 1999, National Agriculture Insurance Scheme 99 to 2006, Weather-Based Crop Insurance Scheme 2007, Modified National Agriculture Insurance Scheme 2011, and PMFBY, that is Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana 2016. We also analyzed impact of insurance coverage on volatility of crop yield. The model to model the volatility of crop yield, one needs to identify two components of crop yield, systematic and random. As mentioned by the Salim and Sack, variation yields are identified by these two components, namely, the systematic component is defined as known source of variation and commonly identified with high yielding, genetically modified, disease insect resistant varieties or other technological innovation and changes in crop insurance programs. Any deviation of yields from the systematic component is called the random component. It is a systematic component of variation that we are actually interested in. One of the measures of the systematic risk is called the coefficient of variation of the spatial systematic risk and measure the temporarily invariant spatial yield risk. SSR for India for each year from 1999 to 2007 is computed as the ratio of the standard deviation over mean of temporary invariant spatial yield risks. Rice shows highest yield volatility till 2007-08, after which SSR of the rice fell steadily and remained almost constant at around 0.4. After rice, wild seed and sugar cane exhibit fluctuation in SSR with no significant difference between the SSR value at the beginning of the period of analysis, that is 1999, and that is last year, that is 2017. SSR for the wheat had hardly shown any considerable fluctuation throughout the period. We use a linear regression between SSR and the insurance coverage along with other variables to answer the question of whether crop insurance program have been successful in mitigating risk in agriculture. In this regard, we have also created one variable that is called total factor productivity variable and put it in the model as an independent variable. And we calculated the total factor productivity Tronquist Hill index for the 7 commodities. We found insurance coverage coefficient to be statistically significant for the rice wheat in addition to the pulses. The result shows that insurance premium reduces yield volatility for few crops. It can be concluded that with the shift to formal channel of finance in rural areas, commercial banks play the dominant role in lending for agriculture operations. Regular flow of the aggregate data on bank credit to agriculture, supplemented by dedicated surveys, have helped public policy towards sustainable agricultural growth and supported self-sufficiency. The innovative banking infrastructure information system has been providing critical input for the policies oriented towards priority sector policies and financial inclusion policies towards the objective of the sustainable finance. Granularity of data supports better analysis and effective monitoring of lending of population groups sector level. While bank financing has supported agriculture growth on sustained basis, crop insurance has supported containing its volatility. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, if pressing questions are there on this presentation, we would like to have it now. And if there are general question on statistics, that use of statistics on credit, that will take at the end after all presentations are done. So on this paper, if any questions are there, please raise your hands.
Madam, SSR is nothing but is a measurement, proxy measurement for the systematic risk. Okay, so we calculated with the model based. Okay, it is nothing. You can say that it is a actual production minus the estimated one from the model. I divided a square root. I divide by its mean. For a state wise, for crop wise, we calculated it, and again for India level, we averaged it. Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you. If there are no questions, you have one, right? So can somebody pass on the mic, please?
This is related with the continuous reduction in the repo rates by the Reserve Bank of India in the recent months and the recent years. Do you have any estimate or can we have any direct relationship between the reduction in the repo rates and the impact on the agriculture credit, quantum of agriculture credit?
I think, sir, Mal sahab will give you answer in a better way because he is handling the policy part.
Basically, it is not related to the presentation.
That is true. Because he is representative from the Reserve Bank of India.
Yes. So basically, the policy rate does not immediately lead to lending rate.
True,
fine. We all know it. Policy rate changes have not been in the same direction all the time. In 2016, there was a easing, then there was some tightening, and then again we are in an easing cycle.
Fine.
Banks' outstanding loans are loans are contracted for fairly long time. There are times when crop loans will be of course maybe quicker, but But when a loan is priced, it is not only based on the policy rate. Then you see the sector's performance and also the riskiness compared to the risk-free yields. So those are the factors that get into it. In case of agricultural loan, you have seen the chart that Saket showed. It was around 13% for fairly long time. You know, 1972 onwards, yeah. that is around 13%. So it has not gone down substantially. Now, the cycles there have been fairly long. There were only two cycles or one cycle. So that also nothing, it was all between 10 and 15%. Maybe it is around 13 on an average. Currently, it is around 13%. So that is on the commercial bank side. There are other institutions also. Some of them charge a bit more, like microfinance institutions, etc. They have higher reach and they price that way. But agricultural credit, as it is, will be seen in relation to. I mean, it is all based on the general asset portfolio of the banks, the way they incur liability that gets factored into their assets. If there is general price decline, interest rate decline, then obviously yeah. there'll be reduction there. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. This is Hemraj from Nepal. I have one question on this insurance that I saw from your modeling that the insurance is statistically significant to contribute on the total factor productivity. As I assume this insurance scheme is weather-based, no? Weather-based index, then what is the collaboration with the meteorological department, and then are there any cases of fraud in claiming this insurance?
You know, sir, there is a sir, our model does not include the fraud incidents. Basically, we have taken the data, insurance premium, and we have calculated the SSR, and we regress this SSR with the help of the total factor productivity as well as the insurance coverage, etc., and then observe that whether the insurance coverage is a fact or is a important or significant variable on containing the volatility in the yield or not. So, sir, I don't have information with respect to the fraud side of the claim.
The work is not on the level, but on the volatility part and on the margin, basically. So it didn't come significant for all variables, but it had some significance in basically reducing the volatility for some crops. So that was it. Yeah. Okay, thank you, Saket. I now invite Mr. Gangaram Bhattarai. He is very young, only 3 years old in the National Statistical Office of Nepal. And he has done his master's from Tribhuwan University in economics. And he has been working in national accounts. He'll be presenting on the empirical relationship between credit flow and agricultural production. And Nepal, in the previous panel, sir, you explained how difficult it is to even collect data from remote sensing, etc. We look forward to it, and also we'll encourage you to contribute more for such sessions. We are very young. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Upimal, sir. And good morning. Good evening to all the ladies and gentlemen in this hall. My presentation is very brief, and my presentation is simply based on the relationship between subsectors of agriculture production and its respective credit flow. So I have confined my study around agriculture production and formal credit flow only. We have much legal and institutional initiatives taken in order to uplift the level of agriculture in Nepal, even though we could not be able to materialize the targeted output and growth. So in order to draw the inference, this is an observation using the quarterly agriculture production data, and that is GDP and credit flow in the respective subsectors. The SDG has also advocated for the fulfillment and achievements of the goals even for agriculture sectors by 2030. In this regard, it is utmost importance to observe such relationship. But while observing the relationship, I have taken into account only the credit variables. I have assumed all other variables as control variables. My overall this presentation consists of this introduction, legal institutional provision regarding agriculture credit in Nepal, methodology, results and finding, implication and way forward. Very short, I have presentation very short. So, SDG affirms the needs for the holistic and purposeful investment targeting improvement of agriculture productivity capacity and incomes due to the increasing world population and the current urbanization trends. Similarly, credit enables farmers to advantageously use inputs and factors of production by granting farmers more access to resources through the removal of financial constraints. It could lead to efficient resource allocation, increase farmers' technical efficiency, and by implication, increase farmer profitability. If we see the data of Nepal on agriculture and the GDP of agriculture, the credit to agriculture production ratio has been increased from 4% from 2008 to 14% in 2017-18, which shows that the credit flow to the agriculture sector has been significantly increased. However, the contribution of agriculture in GDP has been declining. At current in this fiscal year, it is approximated that about 26% of the Nepalese people are engaged in agriculture, and its contribution to GDP is about 26%. In this background, it has immense need to observe the relationship between the agriculture production and formal credit flow, as it is very hard to capture the unregulated and unreported credit flow to the real farmers. And we have legal provisions. Major legal provisions are advocated by the Constitution of Nepal, periodic plans, APP, that is 20 years plan, agriculture perspective plan. And about the Constitution of Nepal, it has emphasizes the agriculture development, protecting and promoting rights and interests of the peasants, and utilizing the land use policy for increasing production and productivity of agriculture and for the commercialization, industrialization, diversification, and modernization of agriculture and planning of agricultural tools and an access to market and appropriate prices for the producer. Similarly, about the periodic plans, the first periodic plan started in 1956, and modern agriculture development has been initiated since 1956. The fifth plan of Nepal has highly emphasized on the agriculture sector to obtain higher economic growth and poverty reduction. Similarly, the 14th plan of Nepal has also given high priority for entire agriculture and rural development spectrum. And if we talk about the agriculture prospective plan, it's a 20-year plan. It has accelerated the growth rate in agriculture through the increased factor productivity, and it was emphasis on the technological-based green revolution in agriculture, ensuring regional balance. And some major institutional provisions are the establishment of NARC, National Agriculture Research Council, is the main agriculture research center and is responsible for the study of improved breeding and improved nutritious feeding for fish and livestock. Similarly, we have ministry which is advocating various programs regarding the agriculture development. It's advocating for National Agriculture Policy 2004, focusing on enabling the environment for agriculture-led rural development. Similarly, after the Agriculture Perspective Plan, we have Agriculture Development Strategy ADS 2014, this report is to present overall strategy for ADS, including a 10-year action plan and roadmap for rational based on the assessment of the current and past performance of the agriculture sector. Similarly, apart from this, the Ministry of Agriculture and Livestock Development has formulated and implemented 20 other policies for the agriculture development. Similarly, we have CBS,
that is NS of Nepal, who is conducting various agriculture service, agriculture census, and various ad hoc services in order to measure the status of agriculture development. Similarly, we have district agriculture offices. And regarding this present study, I have used the data on following backgrounds. I have categorized the agriculture production data, agriculture GDP data, and the credit into four different parts. Now, one is crop, livestock, forest, and rest in other agricultures. And these are the data that shows the trends of the subsector of agriculture and credit disbursement. First graph shows the forest sector's GDP and sectoral loan flow on this. Second, crop sector's GDP and sectoral loan flow. Similarly, livestock sector's GDP, and the last one is other sector's GDP and sectoral loan flow. This shows that the GDP of the subsectors of agriculture are moreover stationary. And the credit flow data is not stationary. That these is credit variables data, credit flow data are stationary at first difference, are made stationary at first difference. And I use the following methodology for analysis. These data are based on the quarterly agriculture production data, that is GDP data, as provided by NSO, that is Central Bureau of Statistics of Nepal, and the credit flow data are based on the supplied from the Central Bank of Nepal, that is Nepal Rashtra Bank. I have used four ordinary least square regression model to observe the relationship between credit flow and production. Following are these are the equations, GDP, CP, and these are the first equation showing the relationship between crop production and GDP of crop and the disbursement of loan on crop sectors. Similarly, second equation showing the relationship between livestock sector GDP and sector loan disbursement on the livestock sector. Similarly, third showing the relationship between forest sector GDP and the credit disbursement on the forest sector, and last one is other sectors. And these are the results I obtained from the result. And this result shows that there is significant positive relationship between the production of agricultural subsector and sectoral credit flow. The other factors are assumed to be control variables, as I stated earlier. However, the targeted production and growth is not materialized as compared to the efforts and initiation taken by the respective stakeholders. The growth in agriculture has remained stagnant over decades despite a number of plans and policies, national and international supports. The contribution to the GDP and people's engagement is very declining every year. The agriculture sector in Nepal has been facing a number of problems ranging from policy to implementation level. The traditional agrarian mode of agriculture sector adopts advanced technology. And last one is the implication and the way forward. It would better government make legitimate provision to simplify the legal procedure for the credit taking, as well as encourage the expansion for formal credit source to reach as much as possible to the farmers, because the farmers are compelled to take loan from the unreported source. Because the unreported source are very likely less hard to get loan. The other reason behind the detrimental effect in the agriculture production is due to the loopholes and leakage in the policy implementation. Hence, effective implementation of the programs and policies targeted to the farmers and to increase the agriculture production need to be initiated through sound monitoring and supervision practices. Only then the policy could be materialized and reap the output as per the target. That's all my presentation. Thank you.
So any questions? Yeah. If you have.
Yes.
result, you are trying to regress one dependent variable using one independent variable. So that is elementary set of regression you have done here. So I believe if you could use something more control variable, like inflation or other sector growth, like services sector or manufacturing sector, what are going on there, because the agriculture sector is the basic, the elementary fuel for the, the services and manufacturing sector also. So if you could examine simultaneously both, all three together in your regression setup, then you could get much better result, whatever you have shown.
Thanks. Thank you, sir. But it, the question is very good, and I would like to answer the question. I want to observe the relationship between the this crop sector disbursement, sectoral loan disbursement, and the agricultural production data. Maybe there are many other, there are many variables that are affecting agricultural production, but I am taking this variable just for the observation. That's my.
Now we'll thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Now I invite Mr. Farhad Nauparast. He works for the National Statistical Office in Iran for the last 17 years, and he has domain knowledge of agricultural statistics, consumer prices, and national accounts. Currently, he's in dealing with national accounts, and he has done his master's from the Tehran National University, and he has been very eager to participate in this. He is seeking feedback on the presentation, the methodology that is used, and it's very interesting. Let us see what he presents to us.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. For more production, we need more capital formation. Capital formation in each country should be based on comparative advantages in economic sectors due to the different production possibility curves. In regional planning, recognizing the relative advantages requires to identify regions with their capabilities. The final goal of this planning is the efficiency using of capital as a scarce production factor. Classification and ranking of regions is one of the priority ways for investment in different sectors by using specific variables. I've used numerical taxonomy analysis to do this, and my paper's title is The Priority Setting of Provinces of Iran for Investment in Agronomy Subsector. Taxonomy, it means classification. Taxonomy concept is a system for naming and organizing things, especially plants and animals, into groups that share similar qualities. Usually it is used in biology and botany. In the numerical taxonomy, we have two things. Number one, objects, and number two, properties. In my paper, objects are provinces or prefectures of Iran, my country, or rows of a matrix. And properties describes objects. In my paper, properties are variables or columns of matrix. The numerical taxonomy technique has several steps, logically and sequentially. Step one, data matrix formation or matrix A. Data matrix contains information about the properties of a number of objects with n rows of provinces and p columns of variables. Definition of variables is very important. Choosing the right variables is the basis of a good analysis. Step two, normalized matrix formation, matrix Z. Due to the inconsistency of the variables, we need to normalize them. We normalize our variables. By normalize our variables, we compare them better. Step three, compound interval matrix formation, or matrix D. This step we use to compute various measures of similarity or dissimilarity between all pairs of provinces. Since the provinces have special conditions and properties, so we need to homogenize them. For homogeneity, we calculate the distance of each province from each other by this below relation. It's obvious that the distance each province from itself is zero. This calculation yields a matrix D, a square and symmetric matrix with a diameter with zero. And step four, optimal diagram formation. By obtaining homogeneous regions as a group, we can draw an optimal graph or pass analysis diagram. This diagram is plotted by pattern object. This diagram is an important output of numerical taxonomy. Step five, final step and last matrix. The final step is to calculate the ranking of provinces. Then we obtain the distance of each region from ideal value or maximum value with this below relation of CIO or interval of object. As you see this relation, obviously each column of this matrix will have a zero array. CIO shows the ranking of the provinces compared to the to other provinces. The smaller CIO has the smaller distance from the ideal value and has the better position. The ranking of the provinces, we calculate, to ranking the provinces, we calculate the mean of CIO and its standard deviation, and then use below relation, as you see this relation in this slide. And then we compute the CIO divided to CO ratio, CIO to CO ratio, the development rate of region or province, which we show by this CIO divided to C, we call it FI. The value of FI will be between 0 and 1. If FI be close to 0, the province has more potential for investment and higher returns for investor on a specific activity. Certainly, the following relationship, 1 minus FI, introduces the degree of the development for each province. Run the steps. Step one, data matrix formation. There are 28 provinces in my country, Iran, and I've defined 17 variables. Most of special variables are related to agronomy subsector. For example, X1 ratio of province agricultural land to province area in percent, ratio of cropland to total agricultural land of province in percent, ratio of irrigated agricultural land to total cultivated agricultural land in percent, productivity rain-fed wheat in province in hectare by kilograms, productivity of irrigated wheat in province in hectare by kilograms, and other variables are about, for example, literacy rate, population of use in province, agriculture workers or holders in agriculture, value added in agriculture, rural population. There are 17 variables in this technique. I've defined 17 variables. And step two, normalize matrix formation with this simple formula, and it's clear. And step three, compound interval matrix. Step three, compound interval matrix formation, matrix D. This is a square matrix, symmetric and with diameter by zero. And step four, I draw the optimal diagram in this slide. This diagram shows provinces with each other by computed similarity coefficient. In the next slide, I explain a piece of this diagram. For example, please don't attention the numbers inside the circles. This numbers are not important. At the above of this diagram, the first dash 14. This is a name of province in my country, and I related a number for each province for your understanding. As you see in this diagram, a piece of previous diagram, the previous slide, the province number 14 and province number 12 are similar to each other. And only province 12 is a pattern province to another two province in the bottom of diagram, number 28 and number 2004. And there are coefficient similarity between these provinces. But for example, only province number 12 can be a pattern province to another province. Which provinces? 28 and 04. And final step, ranking provinces from matrix CIO. This result is earned from almost 5,000 number computed I have in this in the Excel software. The highlighted column is name of provinces, and the second column is value of 1 minus FI, and the third is ranking. Province number 14 is the first in this ranking. For example, number 12, province number 12 has one, the value of 1 minus FI is 0.53 and 40 is the second in this ranking, and so on. According to the Ministry of Commerce in Iran, the highest amount of wheat purchased from farmers in recent years is belong to the this province number 14. I want to see this results almost is correct, but not exactly. And this chart is belong to value of 1 minus FI. And the next slide is about discussion and conclusion, or merits and demerits of numerical taxonomy technique. Numerical taxonomy is, in fact, for biology and botany. At least I have not seen research in economics. It refers to the methods that classifications are formed based on similarities. One of the demerits of numerical taxonomy analysis is that it doesn't consider correlation of variables, and so the results have bias. Therefore, the solution is to first select variables by using factor analysis and use its output as input to numerical taxonomy analysis. The number of variables vary for different operational taxonomy units and is depending on types of activity and variables. In biology and botany, scientists sometimes study 100 to 400 variables, biologists. But in economics, I don't have any experience, and only myself use 17 variables. Every variable have, this is a point for this technique, every variables have equal weightage in creating ranking. With attention to ideal value in step five, it is necessary that in the data matrix, the variables selected in the numerical taxonomy analysis be either positive or negative. If the variables are positive, the maximum number of each variable is ideal value, and vice versa. For example, if all of the variables is negative, minimum value is ideal value. And in the last slide, global policy making. In all countries, capital is a scarce factor of production. Therefore, one of the tasks of governments is to guide investors in the country to the right places through regional planning and to prevent capital loss through proper legislation and policy making. And I think the numerical taxonomy can help us. This technique gives us a signal. Although this is not exactly or not isn't sufficient, but this technique gives us a signal for investment. On a global scale, this technique seems to be able to determine the relative advantage between countries and even continents around the world. We, the people of the world, need to be together in this global village and to work in the production of goods, especially agricultural products, in order to activity maximum productivity in the world without selfishness and violence. We can use numerical taxonomy in monitoring disaggregation of indicators, and I, if you let me, I point this, this ranking only, for example, belong to agronomy subsector. If I we want to study, for example, fisheries, the ranking change certainly. Thank you so much.
Time for questions. Very interesting paper.
Yeah, yeah. Please. I think it's very interesting paper.
Thank you.
Disaggregation of SDGs, and it is also particularly very relevant for a country like India, where we have so many villages, I think 5,000 or 6,000 villages, and the government is coming up with a program of 6 lakh villages. Yes, 600,000 villages, and government is coming up with a program of one village, one product. So it's a very innovative and cross fertilization type of paper, and I really like it. I must appreciate.
Thank you so much.
And because my paper, I want to generate some discussion. So if you don't mind, I would like to start my presentation and get some discussion, and further discussion we can continue. Sure. This is very interesting topic and needs a lot of discussion.
Thank you. This subject is usually between biologists, but I have not seen, not now, at least I have not seen. I don't know in economics. Is there any paper, yes, numerical taxonomy or no? Yeah. Thank you so much.
invite my co-chair, Mr. Mukesh Srivastava. He has 4 decades of experience on administration of statistics in various domains, both at national and international level. I won't like to introduce him to you because most of you know him.
Thank you, Chair. I will try to be brief because the objective of my paper is just to inform what FAO is doing on credit data, and I need some feedback from you. And this is a particularly unique platform for me because no less than the head of the Reserve Bank is present here. So. When we operate at the global level, we work with macro, very, very macro level data, what is available from websites or which country reports. So this credit data, I think at FAO level is just a beginning. So in that context, I would seek your feedback, whatever ideas that you have, and even later also. Basically, I would like to talk about how the investment flows take place in agriculture. What is the importance of credit data in the context of SDG? And what do we do to analyze the data and draw some inference at the global level? And what has been the FAO's experience in collecting credit data from countries? And the issues that we face. There are lots of issues, and there are many, many aspects of credit data, but we are looking at the global picture in the context of increasing investment in agriculture. So, what is the global context? The World Bank estimated that by 2050, the food demand will increase by 70%, and it will need at least 80 billion annual investments to meet this demand, and most of it will come from private sector. Now, I would not know in detail each country's situation, but my thinking from very long time has been the agriculture, particularly in India, is the largest private sector enterprise. And this is a unique enterprise where the size is big, but the decision is taken at the micro level by each farmers. So the private, how the investment is taking place in the farmer's household, that will determine the direction of investment by and large. Now, target 2A3 of SDG 2, which is reducing hunger, focuses on the necessity of increasing investment in agriculture in order to enhance agricultural productive capacity in developing countries, particularly least developing countries. But we don't have a clear indicator for this target, which should be monitored, right? And then in African context, we have a declaration, it's called Maputo Declaration, which says that the government spending on agriculture should be at least 10% so that they productivity of agricultural sector increases. So in this context, this presentation comes. Now, if we look at the investment in agriculture, it comes from 3 major sources. One is the foreign direct investment. In Africa, this is very important that the many donors go there, bilateral and multilateral, and they would like to invest in agriculture in different ways. It could be in research and technology. It could be in terms of demonstration plots, transfer of technology, or it could be any form. There are many, many ways. So there is some work being done in FAO to gather data on foreign direct investments also. Then the second aspect is the many governments themselves invest in agriculture. And then for measuring that, we use and recommend countries to use COFOC. It is a classification for government expenditure by functions of government. Some countries have implemented, other places has not been implemented. So wherever we have it has been implemented, we have very clear definition that what items of the government expenditure should be picked up to get an estimate of government expenditure on agriculture. And there is a database in FAO on that based upon what we get from countries. Then is the private investment. Private investment can come from farmers themselves, small farmers, or in the companies. And then the farmers also, they have formal and informal credit. The credit flow structure, like which institutions are acting, it may differ from country to country. As was said in the Reserve Bank paper, that in India, the credit, more and more credit is flowing now from the formal sector. That was the major effort. I don't know how much exactly now, because the informal sector is unmeasured. That's my assessment. So we don't know exactly what is the total volume that is coming from informal sector. So, and then, I don't know whether you can see this web link, but later you can go through this web link and see what data FAO has in its database on credit. And here we have data for some 27 years from 1991 to 2017 on 120 countries. And we standardize this data by currency, and we provide data both in local currency as is reported in their as is reported on the website of the central banks of the country, and in US dollar, and we use the GDP deflator for converting data on current prices. And we also compile the share of agricultural credit to total credit flows in a country. Again, it is this database we create by getting what we get from the reserve central bank of each country. So what if there is uncovered credit that is uncovered in FAO database also. Then we also propose to use an agricultural orientation index for credit to agriculture, which is more meaningful or more informative in our view. It's very simple as compared to just seeing a share of agricultural credit in total credit. Now, based upon database, we came up with this picture. Like how much percentage share of agriculture in total agricultural credit. We take 5 years average for different countries, and how many countries come by that percentage. So this kind of chart shows that nearly 80% of the countries, the agricultural credit is less than 10% of total flow of the credit. And if you see, about 3.3%, 50% of countries, the agricultural flow of agricultural credit, share of agricultural credit to total credit is about 3.5%. And then the next chart you will see from 91 to 2017, we have what are the trends of share in agricultural credit in different regions of the world. And the red one is the other developed countries. You see, their share of credit is about, what is it, 2%. And in Latin American countries in 90s, there have been a lot of investment, but then it has gone down. So what is our agricultural orientation index? Is nothing but very simple thing. How much credit flows to agriculture out of the total credit flowing to the economy, and what is the share of agricultural GDP in the country? So ratio of the two, that is much more informative, and this is what we call as agricultural orientation index, and we observe that. So this is a kind of graph that we do using our database, what we get, that so many countries, the agricultural orientation index is less than half. If it is near one, that means it's okay, equal priority. What agricultural contributes to the economy, it gets the same share in the credit. If agricultural orientation index is two or more, then the country is doing, has a positive bias for investment in agriculture. I would not go in detail what each country is going, where India is. You can yourself click in the database and find out. Now, my discussion is more on issues that are facing us in preparing this database. The first thing is that for any good statistic that we do, we need international guidelines which should take into account the country situation, country practices, and it should clarify the concepts and definitions which country follow. Now, each country may be following a different concept, definition, classification based upon its own context. But for at global level, there has to be some document which take into account most countries' situation, and it should be some sort of overarching guidelines. In the case of credit data, we don't have anything like that. Dr. Mal, you can inform me if there is. I mean, I'm not very much informed on what Reserve Bank does, but for for financial management, yes, there may be. But if somebody wants to compile for global purposes, then we find some defect. Now, another issue is that when we collect the data, what is agriculture? This also differs from countries. Some countries report information, their agriculture is just crops and livestock. For some, fisheries is included, somewhere livestock is included. So from different countries, we get different combinations of these four subsector, which is crop, livestock, fish, and forest. And this is as per the ICAS definition. So not every country has adopted the ICAS definition. And also then, we need to make a distinction when we are collecting data, talking about credit. Is it the credit sanction? Is it the credit disbursed in this year? Or is it the credit outstanding on a particular point of time? So what we get when we scrape the data from different places, we are confused on that. This is our challenge. Then most banks in the world, they report data by institutional SNA sector, that this much of credit is going to household, it is going to non-financial corporation, government or non-monetary financial corporation. And we do not get data by economic or industrial sectors, like so much agriculture, so much crop, so much livestock, fish. And this kind of disaggregated data is very much needed, not only by the government, but international communities for making investment in right type of subsector or sector in that country. Donors come with a bag of money, I have to invest in agriculture. Where do I put it? Whether fish or crop or livestock, they need this kind of information, where there is weakness. So, last point I already made, that ICAS revision 3, definition is not followed by most banks when we get data from by web scraping. Also, we do not know what is the extent of coverage of data reported from Reserve Bank, not RBI. Yeah? I'm talking at the global level, because there may be different structure. There may be commercial bank, there may be non-commercial bank, rural bank, formal, informal, microcredit. We are blind. So whatever we get, on that basis we compile our data, and we are sharing our challenge so that you can throw light what should be done at the global level to improve this database. Of course, the data demand on credit are much more than what is the credit flow, because as we know, the farmers may take may make a declaration of purpose of credit for taking the loan, one purpose, but it may be actually used for something else. I don't know whether we can really capture it or not, but data in some countries through their surveys also, they, like in India, in their surveys, they directly ask the farmer, and that is supposed to be more reliable, which includes like amount of credit that you receive during this year, the term of credit, the purpose of the credit, whether it's for crop, for livestock, or fish, or forest, or land improvement. Why did you take the credit? And that what was the interest rate that you are paying? What was the type of collateral that you provided? What was the source of the credit? Was it informal money lender, the commercial bank, nationalized bank, or so on and so forth? So this kind of data, I think India has a good example of input survey, where along with the agricultural census, they collect this kind of data. And also we need to know how much is going to crop, livestock, fish, and to the extent that people would like to know how much has gone to land improvement, how much has gone for digging a well, because land improvement and digging a well is a capital formation in agriculture. That's another area where the statistics is very, very weak. So I would like to know from you any suggestions, any ideas, now, later, what should be done and what should be the way forward for improving availability of credit data for measuring investment, because it's one of the components of investment. It could be not all credit is investment. Half credit could be for capital formation. Some could be for current use, for credit for fertilizer and seed is not an investment. So, but it is an important source of investment. So how do we go about so that we get a clear picture about what is being invested in agriculture across the world, and in which countries the investment in agriculture is low, where it is high, things like that. So the floor is open. Any comments, any idea, even now or after you have explored FAO website, will be welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. I will, at this stage, I will just, you know, certain issues Mukeshji has flagged, so I'll just give the India position on that. And incidentally, the person who's heading the banking statistics is also here, Mr. Vivek Kumar. So you, Vivek, you supplement if I missed out something. First thing is, how do we measure informal credit? You know, two things are there. When you're talking to a household, the loan for the household may be for agriculture or it can be for any other activity. So it becomes very difficult to segregate that, how much is for agriculture, how much is non-agriculture. Of course, we have rural credit survey from the 1950, which Saket has explained. The issue is, and every year we, every 10 years we conduct it, the last was in 2013, the National Statistical Office does through its NSSO rounds. It was 55% as reported by households. Now you don't have a population figure, unlike you know, the lender side where you have near population figure, borrower side you can never have population figure. And of the total credit, how much is for agriculture, you can have a broad estimate, but you can will not have a precise estimate from the household side. Again, because at the household level, credit is, you know, any fund is fungible. So they say, and maybe they will not use it for that purpose. The other thing is that the investment, exactly they'll not be able to tell the loan was actually for crop loan or for the, you know, seasonal requirement or for investment purposes. So this is a problem in case you go for the household survey and collect this information. So there's a limitation there. But so our focus on institutional funding has to be strong. And that is why the BSR system was introduced, which Saket has explained. Now, first level question is, what is credit? Before we go to credit to agriculture, we should talk about what is credit. Now you can see, you know, there are a lot of, there's a lot of talk about sustainability of credit to GDP ratio and all those things. Credit to GDP ratio is talked a lot. You have to be very careful in that, that for the past years, it is possible that some of them were, you know, banks invest in government securities. In India, we call it SLR, but it is every place, you know, every country, banks are major investors in government securities. So it becomes banks loan to government. Now, when you are talking on credit, you have to be very careful that that loan to government should not come as the credit. But in some countries, this ratio includes government, some countries it doesn't. Of late, it has. So I have to, when I am comparing with another country, I have to be very careful how it is run. So credit definition, over the years, now they are segregating. But for the past years, most of the ratios have been worked out, differently across countries. What is agriculture? In terms of when we are giving credit data, for India, we are very clear. We follow the NIC classification, which is based on the ISIC classification. We have National Industrial Classification. So the codes are as per NIC codes. We collect the data. The very important part of this entire exercise is that you should have a reporting system. Banks, core banking system should have those codes. If the banks don't have those codes, then they cannot generate the required tabulations. So you have to prescribe that banks maintain data in that format. And in India, CBS services are generally around 6-7 major CBS providers are there, and a group of banks are on one or the other. And all of them are BSR compliant, and we, whatever codes we give, they have to classify according to that. So each loan account is classified as per NIC code to the extent we have adopted. Of course, we did not go for very detailed NIC classification because banks can maintain only up to 7 level. So all items of 5 digit, you can't expect it. But definitely broad aggregates are there. And if those items are specified, banks maintain it. The problem there, again, is that banks will give loan for not only one activity, it can be multiple activities, maybe two, maybe three, etc. So it becomes very difficult to actually segregate for small items. And especially small items are clubbed with large items. So there is some element of underestimation in case of the activity is very small. So that is another problem. Now, your question on whether the credit is sanctioned credit or disbursed credit or outstanding credit. Disbursed credit may not be very relevant because it is only a flow information. So we bother about the stock information. And the stock information is on the outstanding position. But at the same time, in India, we collect the sanctioned amount as well as outstanding amount. Not only that, we are very careful also reporting, and it is in public domain. We are one of the rare countries which does this, is that our reporting system also captures where the credit has gone, because we are bothered about the regional distribution, etc. So we are collecting data on how much is where the amount is sanctioned and where actually it is utilized. So maybe Tata Sons or Tata Steel has got the amount in Bombay, and it is used in Jamshedpur, which is almost like 2,000 kilometers away or 1,700 kilometers away. So we will show the amount sanctioned place as Mumbai and utilization place as Jamshedpur, which is 1,700 kilometers away. So you can find out other, if you don't do that, then most of the money will be shown against the financial capital, because most of the headquarters gets the funding and then actual utilization is elsewhere. So that we go to that granular level. And you know all these 200 million loan accounts, which Saket has explained, we are giving detailed tabulations for each state and all the centers. And as per sanction, as per utilization, as per sector of, so this kind of massive release that we do every quarter and generally within one quarter. So that is the timeliness that globally we need. I think what we do is something which most of the countries are not able to do. And this release, of course, you have to rely on technology, you have to train banks, you have to have very clear guidelines. Those are the things that are required for this purpose. Now, take the case of a small item like fish. There may be lending to fisheries, but first of all, whether the banks have that information at that level, whether they got the loan to fishery as one of the sectors, you know, they have to, there'll be check boxes when the loan is sanctioned, for what purpose, so there has to be a check box for fishery. Unless it is there, the information will not get captured. So it will not be, so if there is a, classification is broader classification as direct finance for agriculture, or we separate again crop loans and other loans. And we also capture information on, what is the size of land holding when we are generating this information. So that's why if suppose there is a, anybody having, for example, up to 2 hectares, that the loans given to farmer who has got up to 2 hectare size, we can give you data for such farmers at state level and district level also. So it is that kind of details.
No, thank you very much. I knew that India has a great system. And also I got in touch with the Central Bank of Italy because they were our good reporters. And they also have a similar system where they mail the surveys. And it's not actual filling survey. It's a survey of recompilation of the records. So what it boils down to, your last recommendation, that if these classifications are embedded at the grassroots level when the loan is sanctioned, we could get the data. Now, I take that point as a recommendation, and my link question to you is very pointed, sir. How can an agency like FAO intervene? I think there is some Basel Convention or something under which the banks work, right? How can an agency like FAO intervene there so that this kind of recommendation flows to all countries, and then there is a capacity building to be able to, so that at global level and national level also, global is for national purposes, the availability credit data, better credit data is available. That's my very short answer, and detail we can discuss if it is not clear. Thank you.
I'll leave time for discussion also. Of course, we are running ahead of behind schedule. It is the reporting is generally banking statistics reporting at the global level. Two aspects are done. One is the IMF, which is basically aggregate level reporting, and then you have the BIS reporting, which is also including international banking statistics, etc. At the sector level and subsectors details, I think those are generally national priorities. So there is nothing very, very strong recommendation that has come from any agency, unlike the national accounts or balance of payment. You don't have such recommendation that's for sectoral lending at, for credit. But at the same time, countries have their own internal requirements. And some sectors are applicable for some countries and some others may not be at all. So it again depends, it is left to the countries, and macro agencies will not do this too much. I have a feeling that macro agencies will find it, getting into too much of details may not be this thing. But say in case of Europe, all the European countries have got together and they have introduced a system. They are still building. Their involvement is, I can't recollect the name, but they are still building, evolving, and they're each central bank is involved, each national agency is more involved, and I'll mail you the details of that. Those are the things that are getting done, and at least in Europe, I'm very sure that is getting done. We are running behind schedule, but if any pressing questions are there, or definitely some comments, especially from the front row, sir, you have some things.
So very good question, and this question always comes from very senior top level people like you. I'm not joking, sir, the same question was asked by Pietro Gennari to me. And Pietro Gennari has been in the UN Statistical Commission deciding this goal. And I must tell you that this indicator, which I said that to increase the credit, this in target to increase the credit in agriculture has no target. It is for this reason why it doesn't have a target. It's because this is a country-specific question. The variables that are to be taken into account for deciding, number one, returns to scale. Variables. That's why.
In terms of investment.
Right.
I am associated with health sector also.
Right.
वो कहते हैं कि 3% health को जाना चाहिए.
Right.
Agriculture को कितना percent जाना चाहिए? Education को कहते 10% होना चाहिए.
Right.
Now, do we have any something ideal or value
for agriculture? I would not say that these things have any ideal at a global level. Country-specific level, where the country stands at the development level, because there's a competition between the funds, right? So you have to see what you want to prioritize, what is your development strategy. Some countries prioritize education first, health later, health first, education, then food. So looking at the development indicators of the country, the finance ministry or the planning commission prioritizes investment, and there is a competition always. So this is a political decision, which always has to be country-specific, and there should not be global recommendation. There should not be. I'm not in FAO, and that's why I'm saying there should not be a global recommendation on that. No, it's general, I think. Political party is represents a particular economic policy. Right? They have a philosophy behind. So, that's it.
And one point I would like to supplement is that, you know, when we are talking of this much, you know, the way quote budgetary supports at 3%, 5% to health and education, etc. But these are basically recommended for FISC, that is the government finances, the budget support, and not the credit support. Credit is basically based on the market demand and supply, and the stage of the economy becomes very important there. If you are having very rich farmers, they may not need. For example, most of the software companies are very rich. So if you see credit to software companies, you'll find that practically it is zero or they are in surplus. Whereas in case of some other sectors which are very capital intensive, the loan sizes are very huge. So those are the kind of things that get into it.
I just gave an example, Maputo Declaration. All the heads of the Africa people, they agreed and they said, okay, there should be 10%. They might have done some studies and seen somewhere 5% required, somewhere 15% required. They decided we will do 10%. What is happening after that is a different issue, right? So these are global calls and they help to direct the investment. These are needed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This was very lively discussion. Of course, probably if time was more, we could have gone for another 15 minutes, but there is another parallel session which would have started by now. So we need to move to that. Thanks to all the presenters and especially to Mukesh ji.
Thank you.